Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to today's very exciting seminar in Ukrainian studies. Thank you so much for joining us. Good afternoon if you're here in the US on the East Coast. Good evening if you're joining us from Ukraine. My name is Emily Channel Justice. I'm the director of the Temerte Contemporary Ukraine program, and I'll be moderating today's event. And I'm really delighted to be joined by Professor Serhy Yekelchyk, who is a professor of history and Slavic studies at the University of Victoria in Canada. Professor Yekelchyk obtained his PhD from the University of Alberta. He is the author of 7 books on modern Ukrainian history, Stalinism, and Russo-Ukrainian relations. His most recent historical monograph is Stalin Citizens, Everyday Politics in the Wake of Total War, which came out with Oxford University Press in 2014. And you may know him best for the publication Ukraine, What Everyone Needs to Know, which was also Oxford University Press, and that has recently been updated in 2020. And that is really one of, I think, the best books on contemporary Ukraine that gives a great overview, you know, not only on the major events going on today, but the role of history and the role of memory and commemoration in developing contemporary Ukrainian politics. And so I'm really excited for today's talk, which is entitled The Birth of a New Memorial Culture in Ukraine After the Euromaidan. If you are watching on YouTube and Facebook, please submit your questions there. They'll be forwarded to us. And if you're joining us here on the webinar, please use the Q&A function and I will read out the questions during the question and answer period. But for now, I will turn it over to Serhy Yekelchyk. Thank you so much for joining us.
Hello, my pleasure. Thank you so much for inviting me. Thank you for the team to making the arrangements. It's a pleasure to be addressing the audience, which is transnational, and some members of which audience may possibly know more than I do about some of the monuments I'm going to discuss today. I have taught once in my life at Harvard Ukrainian Summer School, and I can tell you that it's an incomparable experience because you get to meet brilliant young people from around the globe, and then you maintain contacts with some of them for a long time. And this time I know some of you are actually from the University of Victoria, which is finally an achievement for my home school to send a graduate student there. Now, the topic of my talk today represents my first exploration of a new research theme. And I'm in a position of learning about it. And some of the ideas I'm going to explore today, I haven't had a chance to explore before. And I'm going to go straight into it by sharing the screen and showing you my PowerPoint, my brand new PowerPoint. Okay, can you see it? All right. So the new forms of commemoration after the Euromaidan Revolution, or the Revolution of Dignity. This is the topic which I found strikingly obvious for any observer of the revolution. All of us were glued to the screen, or some of us actually perhaps participated in the revolution, and you have noticed right away that the commemoration was part of the revolution itself, that it happened spontaneously in a very interesting way right during the days and months of the revolution. And it unfolded in such a way that the commemoration itself became a reflection of the revolution's values and part of the revolution, which also granted commemoration itself a sacred status, which is very interesting. It doesn't actually happen often. in history when the traditions develop before the revolution takes over, and then they are acknowledged by the powers that be. And some of them continue to exist in the shape in which they first developed during the revolution. There are quite a few of them we can talk about. But what is important for our analysis is a combination of this spontaneous, somewhat folk tradition of commemorating the dead, which has a lot in common with the urban tradition of building monuments in the cemeteries, something in common with the urban and highway tradition of building roadside memorials, and something deeper with the folk tradition of crying over the bodies of those killed and maintaining their memory in a traditional way. And so all of these things came together in the initial development of traditions. They included, as you know, the by now the famous song "Pliva kacha po tesini," which became spontaneously, unpredictably, the memorial tune of the revolution. And ever since the funeral of Mykhailo Zhizhnevsky, it became a tradition, a song associated specifically with the dead heroes of the Euromaidan, and subsequently also with the fallen soldiers in the Russian-Ukrainian war in the Donbas. But there is more. Spontaneously also, things developed like the greeting Slava Ukraini and the response Heroyam Slava, which was reimagined right away from its historical tradition during and before World War II as a slogan of the organization of Ukrainian nationalists, into something else, into the heroes that were the actual fallen heroes of the Euromaidan itself. There was also, of course, the obvious tradition of building small crosses to mark the sites of death, and building makeshift shrines adorned with flowers and candles, and often photographs. The tradition of applying photographs has something to do with also the commemoration of Stalinist terror and the Holodomor. From the Holodomor tradition comes the notion of lighting a candle being a central part of a commemoration. In Bykovnia forest near Kyiv, where the mass graves of Stalinist terror victims are located, lots of portraits are glued or taped to the trees. And when I saw that same thing happening on Institutska Street, now the alley of the heroes of the Heavenly Hundred, it was actually a very recognizable way of saying that this is spontaneous. This is being moved by a simple and immediate human sentiment. This is not an organized effort. And this point is important to me too, because what was also obvious in the analysis of commemoration as it unfolded over the next several years was that the participants of the revolution understood it was new Ukraine that was emerging from the fire of the revolution. That new Ukraine required new ways of commemorating its heroes. And those who died in the name of this idea needed also a totally different approach to their memory. An approach which took some time to crystallize, even so the most important components of it were already present early on. As you see here, this is the image on the right. The location under the clock, on Institutska Street. And for a person who doesn't know the history of the revolution, the clock itself would appear slightly out of context and perhaps not even needed here, distracting people from commemoration. But of course, the components such as yoka, the clock, and others, they became by virtue of location, and this is now an exercise in space, in the history of space, of space commemoration. They also became part of that commemoration. But how is it built? Take a look. These are the traditional funeral wreaths. These are small stela built basically on the same model as modest monuments in Ukrainian cemeteries. But the distinguishing component is the portraits. The portraits and the insistence of those who took care of the site. And initially the volunteers and eventually the organization which took ownership, sort of, there are two basically. There is a museum of the Maidan, but there's also the organization of the families of heroes, the Heavenly Hundred. So they insisted on keeping the tradition of having the portraits of each and every hero of the Heavenly Hundred displayed in an arrangement which may appear temporary, transient, right? But what is interesting about it is that they are all identified by name, sometimes by the location, and they do not become, in this way, a collective image so typical of the Soviet times, where a monument, even so it was figurative and monumental, ultimately represented the collective imaginary image of a revolutionary soldier, a revolutionary sailor, usually in crowding behind the shoulder of Lenin or Stalin. So no such generalization is obvious here. And in fact, no such generalization takes place for significant time afterwards. The initial structure of commemoration is preserved. Even so, it's a very interesting structure. So what kind of explanation can we find here? My theory is that the very nature of the revolution, emphasizing the chorus of individual voices, human rights, and democracy as an art of collective government, as a right of society to control government and state, actually necessitated such an answer to any generalizing Soviet-style monument or monument of the type produced in independent Ukraine, a monument to the leader, let's say, Stepan Bandera, right? So each and every of them remained an individual, identifiable, not faceless, but actually with a face which was becoming increasingly familiar to passersby and those paying respect. And that in itself was a new development, a development which was rarely formulated, but observed by a significant number of people. Now, the revolution also demonstrated for historians of Soviet urban spaces its ability to redefine the existing urban landscape. And here, as you see, okay, I see something in the chat. All right, that's not for me. All right. Those who lived in the Ukrainian capital before the revolution generally had a fairly low opinion of the independence column erected in 2001 under the government of President Kuchma and seen as kind of being designed in poor artistic taste and almost as part of an underground shopping mall. Which is basically the wall behind it is providing light for the underground shopping mall. And other monuments on the square as well were basically laughed at in the early 2000s. You don't see the figure on top of the column, but that woman was basically a subject of great many jokes. Now, the actual fire, and here it is, and not a metaphor, but the actual fire of the revolution changed the square in a major way. Because these architectural components were part of the actual fighting, they also completely redefined their meaning, which is important because the independence column now developed as a center of commemoration. It is usually surrounded by exposition shields with information about the revolution itself, the commemoration, the territory and such. It is also the place where bodies of the fallen soldiers are sometimes brought from the front almost like a chapel of the revolution, especially because the construction allows for that. And of course, now that the Column of Independence acquired that interesting new meaning, we can see that it had from the very beginning a neo-Baroque design, which is suggestive of the Ukrainian architectural tradition in a major way of a Ukrainian Cossack past as well. Pretty much the same happened to the sculpture of the founders of Kyiv, the alleged founders of Kyiv. But here also I included from Kharkiv, the two images. I could have included more images from Kharkiv, just in order to show that this did not have to happen. In Kharkiv, of course, there existed a monument of independence. Actually, the original monument of independence was somewhat like the Kyiv column. It was also a column, but it was disassembled and a new one constructed under Yanukovych. This is the new one you see here on my overhead. Here it is, with the Ukrainian flag added subsequently to Ukrainianize it a little bit. But it continues to be seen by Kharkivites, or at least by the patriotic Ukrainian ones, as a symbol of bad artistic taste, really. A design which is borrowed from, I don't know, table clocks of Napoleon's time, which is not original or artistic. And moreover, on top of that, was opened by Yanukovych. And so associated in this way with the corrupt administration of the city and that period, and President Yanukovych himself. And so in Kharkiv, for instance, the center of Maidan became the Soviet monument to Shevchenko, which you can see in a variety of ways of more as more of a Soviet monument, as more of a Ukrainian monument, but by now it is also the phenomenon of the Maidan. It acquired new meaning in this way. And this is promising because in my research, I want to look also at the evolution of Soviet monuments. Those that survived are still standing, and some of them are reimagined in radical ways, and how this reimagining is happening. Right. Okay, that's too fast. All right. So here we are. What can we say about the Soviet monumental tradition? Was it helpful at all in preparing the new Ukrainian authorities and new Ukrainian citizens to develop a new tradition of commemoration? The tradition of commemoration, which would be an appropriate answer to the democratic revolution, to the new type of society which they wanted to emerge from this revolution. It's not an easy answer, but basically most of it is in the negative. A few images, I think all of them are coming from Kyiv in this particular slide, but you're going to see some other cities later on as well. First, the October Revolution monument, which used to be almost in the same place where the Independence Column is, as you see, a huge Lenin, and this time the workers, the assorted workers and soldiers are at his feet. And the monument itself, actually, when it was still there, was making a bit of an impression of an Egyptian pyramid, so that it's so high over there, and the steps were too high as well. It was designed as a place for parades and rallies, but for that very reason, it was the first one to be removed, because it was the central political location of the state. And it already shows us the main idea of Soviet monuments. As a rule, they spoke to the audience in a dictatorial tone from above. They never really engaged with the people on the same level. There were never intimate portrayals of revolutionaries, which you could encounter in some socialist countries, Yugoslavia in particular. I remember as a student of Kyiv University being shocked by nature of monument in Zagreb to Moshe Piade, one of the ideologues of Yugoslav socialism, which was like a park statue, right? So So other Soviet monuments could include an idea which was abstract, but usually not in the form which challenged the Soviet artistic conventions. So the monument to the unknown soldier in Kyiv is in many ways a very special place, a place which was aesthetically an equivalent of de-Stalinization constructed under Khrushchev, a pet project of the Ukrainian authorities at the time who wanted to please him. It was in fact a monument, not to the great, not to the motherland and not to the great general, but in fact to the unknown soldier. And it's for a good reason, that under late Brezhnev period, the Soviet Ukrainian authorities were building a replacement to it, a replacement here. Why a replacement? Because the official explanation was because they didn't have educational space near the monument to the unknown soldier. But the real one was that they needed it to be a monument to the state, the cult of the state, and also an educational center as well. But come to think of it, of course, the stela, the architectural form of the stela, and I have to say that according to my research, Khrushchev had a few foreign trips in the years leading to the construction. And he visited two monuments to unknown soldiers in other countries. That was probably his signal that that's something they could do. The form itself, I would hesitate to call it abstract because it was so familiar to the Soviet citizens from its small form on the usual monument on mass graves in villages and districts. But on a such scale, it at least disposed them to think of abstract forms of commemoration. Then, of course, it was replaced by the one which did not allow participation. And I wanted to select this image in particular because here the eternal flame not only is so far from the statue itself, but also it's really impossible to lay flowers there because it was not the aim of the monument, the interaction, the engagement. The conversation with memory was not part of the project, but it was part of the project of the unknown soldier. Other hints at abstract forms, I could go on with them. Just wanted to show you, of course, the arch of the friendship of peoples, now provided with a crack in it, because the friendship, of course, was broken by the Russo-Ukrainian war, by the Russian aggression. But it's a curious one, too. On the one hand, it is an abstract element here, but on the other, it actually includes under it the two sculptures, the two groupings, one more realistic, and interestingly enough, the one reflecting the contemporary period is more realistic. The one reflecting the Pereyaslav Council, the times of the Russian-Ukrainian Union, is a bit more, there's a hint of cubism in it if you look at it very carefully. So it's okay in a historical one if the Soviet one is right next door. And I have to say that the most hated monument in Kyiv was in this respect, kind of the most adventurous one. The monument to Chekiste, the Soviet secret police, which used to be on Lybetska Square in the capital, as you see, was departing from figurative form into realm of trying to deliver an idea. In an article I've published recently, I talk more about the heads, the Soviet monuments in the form of a huge head, arguing that the Soviets really liked it because to them it reflected ideology in itself. So there were huge heads of Marx, Lenin, still the greatest head monument in the world is in Russia, Lenin and such. Right, but these monuments too, if they suggested the possibility of a slightly more relaxed artistic language, they at the same time, interestingly enough, addressed the topic which was the most rigid in terms of ideology, that is the Chekists or the cult of the Great Patriotic War. And of course, as you know, today there are numerous attempts to Ukrainianize the motherland statue with projection of lights as well as by decorating her head, making her Ukrainian and such. And the big issue is what to do with the Soviet symbols on the sword and the shield. But no matter how much the Soviet authorities liked the gigantic design of this monument and also the arch, both of them generated significant folklore. The arch, of course, was referred to as a yoke, sometimes the Russian yoke. And about the motherland, the list is too long of the metaphors and nicknames. But very often she was seen as, of course, standing very close to the monastery of Lavra, to the Kievan Caves monastery. She was called Lavrentyevna, the daughter of Lavra. And there are various other ways of actually diminishing the political significance of it. All right. In the meantime in the world, a new language was developing in the practices of commemoration. There are numerous examples one could come up with for that language. But the three I picked up for this presentation are, of course, the Vietnam War Memorial in Washington, D.C., the famous wall, which caused back in the 1960s so much controversy precisely because of its abstract design. And also the principle introduced in mainstream monuments of making them space for reflection, of not suggesting the answer right away. And the monument to the murdered Jews of Europe in Berlin, which perhaps some of you have seen, which also is intended as a place not suggesting an immediate figurative or other meaning, because you have to discover that meaning for yourself. So it may appear as a labyrinth, it may appear as a collection of gravestones and such. And just to connect, to give you an example which is different, one of the great many monuments in Poland to Jan Karski, the national hero, also international hero, because as a prominent figure in Polish underground, he in particular distinguished himself by informing the world about the Holocaust. And he's usually portrayed sitting on the normal scale. On some monuments, not this one, this is in Warsaw, the one in Krakow and others, there's actually a space left on the bench so you can sit next to him, be photographed next to him. He's always impeccably dressed, however, and I can go on a destruction about why that is the case also in the portrayal of Karski. But here is a monument to a hero, right? A hero who doesn't have to be somewhere up above proclaiming the truth he or she knows, but rather the hero who seems contemplative and thus invites you to contemplate with him. There are many more examples. There are excellent examples in Ukrainian diaspora as well. But I wanted to stay here on the Ukrainian territory. And so as soon as in the 1990s, it became clear that A, the local authorities had no money for large monuments, and B, the people were really tired of Soviet so-called monumental propaganda, the monumentalist design of Soviet memorials. A counter memorial of sorts developed, and that form was emphasizing the small scale, intimate portrayals of the actual human figure. Very similar principle as in the monuments to Karski. And here I selected the one to a cultural figure who was also a victim of Stalinist repressions, the Ukrainian film director Les Kurbas. And the one above, actually, it's not so much a memorial to the famous Ukrainian actor and film director as to a character he played in one World War II film. And the enormous popularity of this monument, of course, is a reason to reflect on what is going on, because it is located right next to a major Soviet period memorial, the Unknown Soldier. And yet increasingly, the weddings and other ceremonies are taking place. They visit, they lay flowers to that particular tiny, intimate monument, which thus stresses that the war and ultimately life and survival, were the issues of humanity, the issues of regular men and women who fought in this war. And the meaning of war was that of a tragedy and sacrifice, and not that of a great victory celebrated in Soviet times. And now, of course, one of the most promising, relatively recent monuments in Ukraine, the Lviv project, the space of the synagogues, which was designed, the monument itself was designed by an Austrian, I think, or a German architect, and to some degree uses the language borrowed from the monument in Berlin. But the very decision not to rebuild the synagogue, as you know, under Kuchma rebuilding constantly cathedrals and such, not to rebuild it, but turn it into a place of reflection with some images and quotes from the people who had lived in Lviv but were killed by the Nazis, is that solution in principle was somewhat unexpected and controversial in Lviv, but I think is now increasingly accepted. Now, of course, some projects during independence period were brilliant successes, and others not so much. I could go on for a long time with that, but I decided to select two and try to show what is happening there and how they possibly prepared the ground for the new culture now in development. Of course, the one on the left, it's the memorial of the Holodomor in Kyiv, constructed in 2007-2008. It consists of a number of components, but I think most people visiting the site do not notice some of the components, but they definitely focus on the candle itself and the small bronze sculpture, which does have a name. It's called the Bitter Memories of Childhood, but very few people know about the name. And there is actually a popular nickname for this little girl who is holding 5 years of grain and such. But what really works here? What really works here is that even so, the candle is an answer to the unknown soldier. It is located in the same park. They're visually together if you look on the same line towards Lavra. The candle is more complex. It actually includes a number of components that represent, according to Anatoly Gaidamaka, the designer, that represents the souls of those Ukrainians murdered in the Holodomor. But from a distance, they look like traditional embroidery. You can also see the cranes that are symbol for human soul, traditional in Ukrainian folklore as well. But still, it is actually a major construction. It's a big item. But before you arrive to it, you first arrive at the statue of the little girl. And that statue actually works according to the principle described above on the previous slide. It is intimate and powerful because it is small and you can converse with it. It's actually smaller than most people standing up, right? So you have to, when laying flowers, you kind of almost paying respect to her this way, because she's lower than you, she's at a lower level. And so it actually worked in a spectacular way. Foreign dignitaries now leave flowers at the statue, but it helped humanize the large scale design of the memorial itself. It combined the two elements. And an example from the city of Vinnytsia, which was not particularly successful. That was the monument to Simon Petlura, the Ukrainian revolutionary leader from 1917 to 1921. And it does reproduce the overall setup of a very well-known photograph of Petlura sitting on a bench. In this case, the designers, the sculpture gave him a map indicating Vinnytsia as a temporary capital of the Ukrainian People's Republic at the time. And this statue became a subject of major controversy. On the one hand, it was located in the traditional former Jewish neighborhood. and not Petlura itself, but actually not Petlura himself, but some warlords affiliated with his army did commit pogroms, which the government tried to prevent and investigate and such, but failed basically to prevent them in most cases. But that's what made it prominent internationally. But what happened in Ukraine was actually disappointment. A disappointment with Petlura being too human, sad, unfocused, just sitting on a park bench, not heroic. And neither the tragedy of the Ukrainian Revolution nor the heroic spirit of the Ukrainian Revolution were seen in this particular monument. Moreover, I have to say that the park statues, which have long been prominent in the West, also arrived in Ukraine fairly early on in the 1990s. And that resulted in a certain aversion towards this intimate genre of sculpture with which you can talk. That's because of the assorted Panikovskys and various other kind of funny images put all around Ukrainian towns, very often by private investors, that represent Russian mass culture or Soviet mass culture. And so the very genre of an intimate park sculpture with which you can converse has been compromised to a significant degree. So that's why then in Holodomor, in the case of the Holodomor Memorial, a combination with a candle in the background, with a monumental candle in the background, works also for the little girl. And by the way, her nickname is Oksanka, for those who work in the park and guard the park. Now, what was to change with the revolution of dignity? The obvious expectation for me and for other researchers looking at the Soviet monuments and new Ukrainian monuments was that the abstract language would make an entrance on a large scale, that major monuments in biggest cities would be places of reflection. They would not be figurative. They would not suggest an answer in a forceful way or dictate it, or God forbid, they would not be dictating it from a very high pedestal. And I have to say that the designs in largest Ukrainian cities did confirm the hopes of researchers. Problem is, not too many of these monuments have been turned into reality. The one in the upper left corner is, of course, in Lviv, and this is only the first part of the memorial. But as you can see very easily, it is a wall, also a wall irregular in shape. But the wall, which incorporates, first of all, a space for walkway, a very long walkway, and also the portraits and the names of the Heavenly Hundred, which means it is a place of reflection, but it's also a place of reflection which is faithful to the tradition born out of the revolution itself, of a grand idea actually defended by individuals who are not faceless. They have faces, biographies, and names. So they die as humans. They do not die as abstract symbols. And yet the language to engage with the idea itself is abstract. So it's a very interesting combination, as you see here. The design from Kharkiv, here below, draws on Ukrainian folk imagery as well. On the, what's the term for that? on the flock of cranes flying over, the human souls living together in the name of this idea, representing it in an abstract way, and yet an abstract way which also touches upon the folk tradition. And the idea of locating entirely suspended in the air is, of course, very interesting. So we have to wait and see what will happen in Kharkiv as result, because many of you probably know about the Kyiv situation, where the first competition was won by an Italian team, which had proposed back then a very interesting design, which I honestly loved. And that was indicating the places where the heroes died with maple trees. The design, which however was eventually abandoned because of the complex situation and the conflict between the museum, the two stakeholders, the museum and the families of the Heavenly Hundred. And also because the investigation is still incomplete, and this is one of the reasons why the families of the Heavenly Hundred are not prepared to let the existing landscape go. But the winning design of the second competition, the Ukrainian design, as you see here, is also that of a place of reflection, of a wall of sorts, but its shape is suggested by the existing makeshift design of the actual lower shrine. The upper shrine up there is organized as a collection of portraits in a small chapel, multi-denominational chapel, but the lower shrine and the lower part of Institutska Street of the Alley of the Heroes is already like that. And so it would be a reflection of this popularly developing spontaneous commemoration. The design for the building of the museum, as you see, also grows from the concept of the wall and also grows from the concept of the stelas within the wall, representing the memory of individual heroes. But as I said, these are grand projects. These are grand projects that would require considerable investment, and that are controversial in a way that there is actually a conflict between the concept of authenticity and the abstract reflection of the idea, in that the families of the Heavenly Hundred, for some reason connected to the investigation, but also for other reasons, argue that the landscape should never be changed. But of course, this is not how historical memory functions, not by keeping things the way they are, but by presenting an abstract representation of things which allows space for engagement. And of course, the Maidan Museum is doing a great job in the meantime. Last year they built a cube, a semi-transparent cube within which discussions were held, because the museum is not being constructed yet. Also, President Zelensky said this year that the museum construction will go ahead. All right, and now let's talk a little bit about other ways that are emerging elsewhere in Ukraine. And this is quite an interesting collection of examples here. You probably know that the Heavenly Hundred from the very start, already in the course of the revolution, were represented as angels. Angels with kind of symbolic swords, in reality, of course, wooden sticks and shields. And this is the image which appears on the design of the medal of the Order of the Heavenly Hundred. And so the imagery of angels, creatures with wings, is quite prominent in small local monuments to the Heavenly Hundred, especially in the western part of Ukraine, with a somewhat different funerary tradition of sculpture. But the other images, the images of light, the images of birds, and the images of waves, of wings, very large wings of waves going up, are also shared by monuments constructed in very different regions. And as an example of those, I included the one from Mykolaiv in southern Ukraine. This is the one in the upper left. As you see, the wings, the flames, the birds, representing once again, in this case, human souls departing or perhaps staying to protect the land. Now, that's a more traditional one here, but the one in Ternopil is actually very interesting, because it does combine components of, I would say, perhaps neoclassical or Art Deco in the upper part, but the lower part is more modernist. Even so, you can see a suggestion of perhaps the body of the of Christ, and perhaps the composition similar to Pietà, as well as to the funerary sculpture of Western Ukraine and Poland. But the flames coming here, they do represent also human silhouettes of other members of the Heavenly Hundred who go up as well. They are parts of the monument. And that actually happens quite a bit in others as well. So the stella, the flames, or the wings do incorporate either faces or the actual representation of the people. Now, my favorite perhaps is the one in Vinnytsia, but unfortunately I couldn't find the photograph in the evening, and I have yet to travel there to take my own photograph in the evening. And that is, of course, the tree, the cherry tree with lights, and also the lights that demonstrate that this is the map of Ukraine, of course, the foundation is the map of Ukraine. And so the lights demonstrate the origins of the heroes, from what part of Ukraine they come. And the lights here and the lights on the tree create a stunning impression in the evening, in particular. This monument is at once traditional, incorporating the tree and the profile of the country itself, of the nation, but also it incorporates the lights. And I have to say that the use of the lights, the Ray-Bans of the Ray-Bans in used in commemorations of the Heavenly Hundred on Institutska Street, is also something that developed practically right after the revolution, and many architects are trying to incorporate this component. Somewhat underappreciated, I think, is the Zhytomyr monument. It's part of the building, I understand, it's part of the building of the provincial administration, and it needs to be seen in the evening in order to be appreciated, because the light is a significant part of it. During the daytime, you see the profiles of the people here, the two-dimensional ones. In the evening, you see the names and this main figure, which needs to be lighted in order to be appreciated fully. A very interesting monument. And the final point in the pictures, before I do a brief summary, is actually strikingly simple. And that is, in fact, a major memorial site in Ukraine, which is fast becoming the principal memorial site in Ukraine. So during a recent visit, Anthony Blinken, for instance, went to lay flowers at the Wall of Memory for those falling in the Russian-Ukrainian War. And as you see, this wall shares something important with the imagery of the Heavenly Hundred. It consists with portraits with names and dates. So these people all have faces. They are not generalized this way. And I have to say that actually quite a few monuments to the Heavenly Hundred that do try to generalize, they add the portraits as an additional component, or portraits are installed around the monument in some cases. Actually in Ternopil for some time, but not on this photograph here. And so what is going on here? The wall of the St. Michael's Monastery of Golden Domes, a spontaneous place of paying respect to the fallen, continues in the unmodified form, in the form which is borrowed from the Heavenly Hundred. And originally the wall, that wall was created by the employees of the Military Historical Museum in another part of town, but then relocated to St. Michael's and became there a major center, so much so that before and after parades on major anniversaries, the veterans would go as a group to the wall. These days you see the president paying respect there as well. But this wall actually preserves the original principle of austerity, and yet individual recognition of every member of the group. And so because the wall preserves this principle without trying to generalize, actually, interestingly enough, there was an attempt to build a monument to the fallen next to the Ministry of Defense, but it finally became a really small stela representing a piece of metal destroyed by explosions and a little bell, a ceremonial bell for ceremonies. But interestingly enough, it's a totally different part of town. But there is nothing. And it's been actually kept this way because the stakeholders insist on it being kept this way. And so it actually is telling us something interesting. I could actually go on and speak about what happens to memorials in the locations, memorials to the fallen soldiers. And it's a slightly different dynamics because they sort of respond to the locations of World War II memorials and sometimes the Afghan war memorials, but sometimes they also are in dialogue with monuments to the Heavenly Hundred. But here, the main of them is actually in a new location, a location picked up by a group of enthusiasts and accepted by the state. And that point of accepting the state into the state tradition, which was established, something that was established by the volunteers, comrades in arms, and family members, to me represents the lasting legacy of Euromaidan and the way it continues to modify the culture of remembrance in Ukraine. Now, let me see. I wanted to get out from the previous screen because it wouldn't allow me to see the time and to see any comments or questions here. But I basically finished what I wanted to say. But by way of summarizing, let me just reiterate the big point of this presentation. The commemorative tradition emerges spontaneously. It's not designed, it is accepted. It is accepted in the form which is open and democratic. It's actually very telling, it was not widely reported by Western media, that at some point, under President Poroshenko, the high dignitaries of the state wanted to block time for themselves so that they would come to the lower shrine on Institutska to pay their respect, whereas the crowd would be held by a barrier. But of course, the whole problem is that the revolution was precisely against the barriers. And so the crowd immediately started shaking the barriers and yelling, "Shame on you." So the authorities had to quickly wrap up paying respects, and they never tried it again, neither Poroshenko nor Zelensky. Instead, they actually were trying to move commemorations to St. Sophia Square, which is in a way easier to control. And so what does it tell us? It has created urban space together with memory of a new type. And the continued existence of this urban space, which embodies the memory of a new type, is a guarantee that the people would have access to important symbols and metaphors here. Very famously, the notion of the Heavenly Hundred was used in trying to save a small urban park, a small area in Kyiv, halfway between St. Michael's Monastery and Maidan Nezalezhnosti, when a group of activists basically started a little garden there, and a huge graffito of Nigoyan, one of the most recognizable heroes of the Heavenly Hundred, the one who is also Christ-like somewhat in his depictions, and he was in real life, is painted on the wall high above this garden. And so they were able then to mobilize the memory and commemoration in a fight for a small garden space against the developers. And for as long as the memory remains alive, and this is one of the founding principles of the Museum of Maidan, the National Museum of the Revolution of Dignity, to keep alive the memory and practice of revolution, then it is a place of social action and cultural protest if that ever becomes necessary again. And this new type of memory could only be born from a revolution like the revolution of dignity. Thank you so much. As you see, it's getting dark here in Kyiv. I'm going to adjust the lighting while waiting for your questions.
Thank you so much. Thank you for bringing up so many really wonderful, interesting points. And I think giving us a lot of food for thought. And I'll just take a second to ask the first question if you'll all indulge me, because I really feel a lot of empathy with the story about families, you know, not wanting the space of memorialization to change. I was present for the majority of the protests. That's when I did the bulk of my fieldwork for my dissertation research, and watching those memorials just spontaneously develop in the actual spaces that people gave their lives. You know, I also feel a little bit of pain thinking that those got moved. I mean, that was, you know, that was this experience of people who were living in Kyiv at that time, kind of sharing the experience of knowing what had happened and living through something like that together. And so I think it's very interesting. And I wonder if there are other examples of this that you've come across. Is it something particular about the events of Euromaidan and the time of Euromaidan in Ukraine's history that make people so attached to kind of preserving a single moment in time? And ultimately, in your opinion, do you think that these 10 years later, you know, that these monuments and museums can actually kind of capture the kind of commemoration that we need for those monuments to do?
That's a very tricky question, Emily, but the answer is going to be a simple one. The revolution is not over. Not in a sense in which scholars speak of the French Revolution, you know, being too fresh for historians to write a history of the French Revolution. But the revolution is not over in a very real sense of the criminal cases not being closed, of the killers not being prosecuted, and of the authorities, especially more recently, not demonstrating much zeal even in bringing these cases to closure. Because I think what is at stake there is not necessarily the landscape itself, but the sense of closure. The entire country lacks the sense of closure because, as indicated by the landslide victory of Volodymyr Zelensky, there is an understanding, a widespread understanding in Ukrainian society that the changes for the better were not sufficiently visible and rather limited. And when that happens, it's easy for a historian to say that the revolution is not over, but how do you answer the questions of people who want the memories of their loved ones to be commemorated? And here there are various strategies, some of them rather interesting. So in some famous cases, the bodies were actually taken to home villages. The bodies of some very prominent Maidan victims, one of the top three, really, the bodies are taken home and buried where the parents wanted to have them. And that is the personal closure for them, but it's a personal one, right? And of course, the ceremonies that took place on Maidan were about more than personal memory. They were about the notion of society having its say, of not allowing the system which is exploitative and manipulative and reflects the Russian authoritarian influence to ever come back again. Now, it is beyond perhaps even any political forces, the capacity of any Ukrainian political forces to accomplish that. And so I work with people in the Museum of Maidan, and they take an open approach to it. And the open approach is very interesting in that they create initiatives. They create awards named after heroes of the Heavenly Hundred who promote certain values. So they work with values of the revolution in such way, becoming custodians of way more. They're actually becoming custodians of the idea of society, of Ukrainian society reclaiming its rights. And I have to say, when I participated in the most recent academic event at the Museum of Maidan, there was a massive computer attack on the premises. And on day one, they also had a search in the main office. And when that happens to you, when you participate online and people on the other side, they're museum workers. But the museum, the living museum, is about the revolution, which is not over yet. So there is a way to personal closure, right? But there is no way at the moment for the Ukrainian society to have a collective closure over it, because the revolution is not over. And the war is ongoing. And actually, the war puts the issue of the revolution in a different framework as well, but that would take me too far. But let me just say that it's not in human ability to close the issues of the revolution. But what we can do is to acknowledge that these wounds are still open. And I do understand that the family members feel it in a particularly painful way. That's not just their personal wounds, it's the wounds of the Ukrainian society generally that are still open, right? So the time will come when this landscape will change, but it will be some time still.
And I think that was a great answer to a very challenging question and challenging set of stakes to think about. We have a great question from Nina Basok, who's a student with us in UC 2021. And she says, greetings from Ukraine. Thank you for your presentation. And her questions, I actually also had similar questions to this too. So why would people destroy the monuments of Soviet personalities, but not the Arch of Friendship in Kyiv or the Motherland statue, for instance? I was thinking, why, how do you choose which ones to preserve and which ones to destroy, or why do certain ones get targeted? Does it mean that people are more attached to the symbols of the Soviet Union because it's a part of this recent history and their individual past, but they're not attached to the personalities, and those personalities are actually, somebody that can be blamed for Ukrainian suffering in the 20th century? And then relatedly, she asks, Central European countries got rid of the Soviet monuments and symbols more quickly than Ukraine when they became independent in 1989, 1991. So why has it taken Ukraine so long, over 20 years, to do the same thing? And so why only after the Revolution of Dignity has it become a popular thing to do? So thanks, Nina.
That's a good question, excellent. Thank you so much. I had an article coming out in the most recent issue of the Canadian Slavonic Papers, more specifically on the fate of Soviet monuments that are still standing, but it also engages with the issue of those destroyed. And the answer is pragmatic. You won't believe it. It's difficult to figure out who picks the bill, who pays for the destruction of monuments. So very often presidents, Yushchenko was famous for that, but Kravchuk before him, would say that we need to cleanse the country. But they would come short on, pushing through a decision of whatever special funding to remove all of them. And it all falls on municipal administrations. Now, municipal administrations do not necessarily have coffins filled with money, but also they are playing their own political games. They try to figure out what the interests of the audience is, of the voters are. And so they're in no hurry. So very often these monuments are also protected. And when they're protected, that creates major issues. Sometimes they're graves, like the Vatutin monument here in Kyiv. But very many of them are protected as monuments of art. So what happens then is that radical organizations that otherwise are not particularly notable in Ukrainian politics, they jump on the opportunity. And a group of angry young men and women armed with sledgehammers show up and technically, illegally, start destroying the monuments, which then becomes a fact. And the municipal authorities retroactively then process paperwork, okay, we are removing them from the list and such. But basically, for political reasons and also for a very simple budgetary reason, it's not quite clear who should do the job. And especially in central and eastern Ukraine, it also carries political connotations. Not so strongly now as before, but it still does. and still does. And I have to say that Soviet monuments also come in many shapes. Like the Soviet monument to Taras Shevchenko, which was criticized at the time when it was built as a Stalinist, socialist, realist, and such, by now is a symbol of Ukrainian identity. The 60ers were meeting at the monument in front of Kyiv University, and so it became a Ukrainian place, Ukrainian space. So it's no longer a Soviet monument as such, and the cities and towns are full of Soviet monuments that are not fully Soviet monuments. And of course, there is a spectacular case here in Kyiv, which perhaps some of you are not even aware of, near the Arsenal historical building, which is now in the process of being converted into whatever, upscale shopping malls, upscale residences, like everything in central Kyiv is now being converted into these things. The monument was rededicated in a way that nothing was changed on the monument. There is still a little mountain gun on top of the pedestal, and it still faces in the direction of the arsenal, except the memorial plaque on it no longer reads to the fighters for the Red Power who rebelled against the Ukrainian People's Republic. It actually now says to the Army of the Ukrainian People's Republic, which suppressed the rebellion of the traitors. Now, I wonder how many people have noticed, right? So in order for monument to change the meaning, it also needs to be noticed. And that also explains one way Soviet monuments go. The arch is pretty much abandoned. It never accumulated enough meaning because there were very few rituals associated with it. In contrast, the ritualistic history of the unknown soldier is very rich. In fact, it retook territory back from the motherland here in Kyiv because of this longer history of things happening at the monument. The arch never acquired this connotation. It never became a place of social and cultural practice. And so by now, there's a Klitschko bridge connecting it to what's St. Vladimir's Hill. And St. Vladimir's Hill, and as people march under the arch towards the bridge, I don't think they are paying much attention to the arch. So the arch is basically erased, even so it is there. And it's arguable also that the motherland has been erased, even so it is there. But in a more complex way, because most visitors to the motherland now go there for extreme tourism, to get to the high observation desk, which is actually run by, advertised as place of extreme tourism in Ukraine. Very dangerous, but great pictures, right? And so that's the reason for most people to go there now. And so this erasure or commercialization could happen without actual destruction. It brings me back to the dilemma of society and authorities. So if the civil society demands that this monument cannot possibly be there any longer, then the authorities are going to follow up on this. They will find a way to remove it from registers, and they will find the funding to remove it, as had happened in Western Ukraine in the early 1990s.
That's both so pragmatic and also so conceptual in ways. I was also just reminded of the Kyiv Pride sort of stunt that they did last year, where they put rainbow flags from the motherland statue, which is a kind of repurposing to make this monument that symbolizes so much else symbolize something new and modern. And I think that those types of events are really an interesting practice. I'm going to combine a couple of questions. We have so many fantastic questions and a diminishing number of minutes for this event. So I'm going to combine a question from Danilo Lishtishin, who is asking if there are similarities between the commemoration of Revolution of Dignity and past efforts to commemorate the Orange Revolution. But he also asks, what if you have any predictions on how popular traditions change and foreseeing Ukrainian commemorative monumental traditions evolving in the future? And I just want to connect that to fellow anthropologist Catherine Warner's question. She mentions that you mentioned atonement as an element in new kinds of commemoration in your abstract.
How might new styles play into atonement, and what might the consequences of this be?
Right. Could you repeat the last one?
Yes, the question about atonement. You mentioned this in your abstract as an element of new commemorative sites.
Atonement.
Atonement.
Okay. Yeah. It's difficult to predict how this culture is going to change, obviously. But one thing from the Orange Revolution was actually, as far as I remember, the immediate enthusiasm about creating a museum. Some of you would recall that the graffiti on the walls of central post office in Kyiv were covered for a time with plates, with plastic plates, to preserve them as memory of the Maidan. Subsequently, this disappeared. But interestingly enough, from the very beginning, the direction was that of a museum rather than a memorial. And here I think the explanation is pretty simple as well. It was not a violent end of the revolution. It was a negotiated political settlement due to the weak position of President Kuchma and a number of other factors that made the Orange Revolution seem like an easy victory of civil society. And therefore it deserved a museum for sure, but not necessarily a memorial. And of course, as we all know, things went downhill right away with Yushchenko, Tymoshenko, and the team. And very soon, nobody would even consider creating the Museum of the Revolution and commemorating it. I'm actually talking to the colleagues at the Maidan Museum about that, about the fact that Maidan did not just become the central protest space in 2013, that there is a certain logic. I'm hoping to finish a book about that at some point as well, about the history of Maidan as a physical space, because the first shootings on Maidan happened in October 1905, by the way, which story is of course completely forgotten by now, but there is a certain logic why that would happen. And, you know, when Hrushevsky came back from exile in Russia, he gave his first political speech back in Ukraine, right in the middle of the Maidan, in the same place where the stage would now be constructed for the events. So all these things, they come together in terms of the emergence of popular politics, the symbolic political locations in the city and things like that. But it's a longer topic here. But I think a museum was considered very seriously as far as I remember, but not a memorial. Here though, we have, and here I approach the part of the question from Kathy Warner, is of course that here we have the blood, right? Here we have the lives lost in the name of the revolution. And then, as Kathy has rightly shown in her forum piece in the Slavic Review, then all these folk traditions kick in because the people do know what to do, because they understand that now the social cause, the political cause, and the folk tradition of remembering the dead become one. And that's why it is so powerful. That's why it is so powerful in the current form. In the current form, but it's... The question is whether it can continue existing in the current form, because it's no secret that the sacred places of Maidan do get vandalized sometimes. I'm not sure that the reports make it into Western, even kind of newspapers and other and social networks of Ukrainian diaspora, but they do get vandalized, but usually not on political reasons, but rather by, you know, drunk young people not really knowing what they do. And there are volunteers protecting them. And that is not going to work in the long run. It's also a very active place. And it's a place where recently there was a police chase with a car escaping from the police, running through the barricades into the alley of the Heavenly Hundred and destroying some of the artifacts and spontaneous commemoration sites. Very active urban area. It does, And it does raise all the same issues as the space of synagogues in Lviv, I have to say, right? Because the space of synagogues in Lviv is a beautiful space of reflection about life and thinking about what we could have done and what we should do, not to prevent it in the future, but it's also part of a very active urban landscape. There's a restaurant on the other side, there are drunk tourists, people with bottles of beer who don't know where to sit or to do other things. And that raises issues which are common to Holocaust memorials around the world as well. And there's now interesting research on the whole industry of souvenir gift shops operating in all major Holocaust memorial sites, and how do we approach that. So for now, I think this unique combination of the folk and social and political preserves the kind of immediate raw effect of the value of human life. So here we deal with a sacrifice which was done by people who knew that would happen. And Marcy Shore's book, which I have somewhere on my table as well, about the Ukrainian Revolution, which focuses to a significant degree on the question of when was the moment when it no longer mattered to you and you felt that you were ready to die. And she actually interviews people whom I know very well and they have been my students in a summer school and such. And so she is searching specifically for this existential moment. This existential moment is still there in the existing tradition. I don't know how it is going to be resolved, if it is going to be still present when a major wall is constructed there. It is present by virtue of immediacy, right? How long can immediacy last? I didn't research the previous revolutions really. I know that after World War II, there were plans in Ukraine in particular to preserve some sites, in Europe as well. But they didn't really last too long. So the form of commemoration for the present day could in fact be the online form, right? So as a collection of witness testimony, the collection of images, perhaps a very shocking one. And there are such precedents. I think in Dnipro, the former Dnipropetrovsk, part of the memorial to the ATO soldiers, to the fallen soldiers, was actually just a screen playing constant documentaries. You can also see it in Ukrainian museums these days. So just basically given space for the people to say what they did when they recorded themselves on cell phones. Whether that is going to preserve the raw and immediate, impact of sacrifice is a good question.
Yeah, that's it's fascinating to think about the ways our modern technologies are actually influencing things like, commemoration and memorialization. And I want to take the chance having such widely published historian here who's obviously been involved in, the shaping of these. We have a question from Yusan Su, who's asking about the role of historians in Ukraine's official historical policy. Not only in monuments and commemoration, but also official historiography, textbook writing, state institutions. Have historians been involved? I think you are a historian who is involved to some extent, at least in observing how some of these things are unfolding.
I try to. My most recent published book is actually The Ukrainian Experience of World War II, which was written in Ukrainian and includes also some Ukrainian translations of articles previously published in English. And I do maintain contacts with a number of historians in Ukraine. And I think that there are two trends here that are noteworthy. One, the prompt and inventive answer to the Russian aggression in the form of at first volunteer organizations of historians who were debunking the Russian mythology of Ukrainian history, realizing that that it's the Likbez project, the Eliminating Illiteracy project, who published a number of very high quality books, I have to say. They are not always what you would expect from a popular publication debunking the Russian myth. histories of the Ukrainian Revolution and World War II, for instance, stand out because of the teams participating in them. So there is this immediate response and involvement, which also tells you that, you know, historians like to talk about objectivity, especially in Ukraine. They like to talk about objectivity, and there's a reason for that, because for so many years they were expected under the Soviet Union to be like really working in the interest of the party. But the truth is, of course, that historians, as long as they are aware critically of their own position, should feel free to express this position. They are citizens and they participate in social struggles just as well. And so they do openly. And this, I think, is actually a very interesting development, especially because they managed to produce such a witty response to Mr. Putin's article about Ukrainian history. I think the response circulated in Ukrainian, I haven't seen it yet translated in English, but I hope it will be soon. But the second trend, which I really like, is that the institutions now that do not necessarily have a pedigree in the Soviet system. They're private research centers, like the center in Lviv, the Urban Center for Urban History in Lviv, privately funded, outstanding institution. The Ukrainian Catholic University, which is not a state structure. There are actually state institutions that are new and reflect the spirit of social engagement, such as Maidan Museum. So what I increasingly encounter in Ukraine is not just, you know, good colleagues who understand what it is to be a critically aware and engaged historian, but also people who work at institutions that understand why it is important and in what form it can be conducted. And that is truly a change, because it will take some time until traditional universities and traditional research structures are going to change. But some people from these very structures, they also work for the new ones. They do get engaged, and they get engaged in a meaningful way. I don't know how historians lived before Facebook, quite honestly. I mean, really. Facebook constitutes a significant share of my research. I'm running out of folders on my Facebook, save for this project, save for that project. And the inclusion into social networks does not mean, of course, that historians should establish a certain level of narrative that is, you know, easy enough for the widest possible audience. Not at all. It just means the opposite, that the mass media should be prepared to carry articles that take the audiences to a higher level, which is what it ideally should be. So to what degree the historians shape state commemoration is a complex issue. For instance, there were voices, numerous voices for many years, especially from the left, from some of my friends and colleagues, saying that, well, the problem in Polish-Ukrainian relations was that the Institute of National Memory was headed by Volodymyr Wiatrowicz. For as soon as Wiatrowicz is gone, the Ukrainian-Polish relations would be wonderful. There would be love and mutual understanding. But wait a minute, the new director was recently asked to wait 7 hours before crossing the border and pretty much ignored by the Polish colleagues at the event he went to. So it's not really about us historians and our political differences here. So we can be critical voices, but it would be, you know, to assign too much weight to any particular individual, to say that we can change the country in one day with one smart article. Moreover, an article posted on Facebook will just generate a lot of trouble for you on Facebook. That's all that's going to happen.
Do you have time for one more set of questions? I'll just combine a few and you can comment on whatever you like, if that's okay. And sorry to those of you whose questions we won't get to. We do have a question about the current memorial that's being developed at Babin Yar. It would be interesting to hear your commentary if you want to broach that. We also have a question about the commemoration of the victims of the current war, which you've talked about a little bit, so you can address that if there's more you want to add. And then finally, we have a really interesting question from Darina Sudacek, who's one of our students this summer, who is asking about memorial reintegration of the occupied territories. They still have Lenin's, the celebration of 23rd February. So what should we be thinking about in terms of reintegration and common memorial history of those territories with the rest of Ukraine?
Okay, a lot here. All right, so maybe I start with the last, let me start with the last one. Yes, they live in a very different memorial culture. The same is true for Crimea, and it's a peculiar combination of the Russian imperial and Soviet mythology with social networks involved, with visual images, with all kinds of things. But the thing is, that means in an ideal scenario, when these territories are recovered by Ukraine, the very same strategy can be applied that was applied when the Soviet Union collapsed, demonstrating that it was an oppressive empire. And Ukraine is actually doing a very good job now working finally with the legacy of the Crimean Tatars. And I think the state efforts to organize a Crimean forum, Crimean platform at the highest possible level, including ideally presidents of other countries, they speak into the same direction. So it's not necessarily the right time now to make plans about what would be done. But I think the strategy would work for Russia itself, because the Russian mythology of World War II is very vulnerable. It is open to various subversions, and it's not going to be too difficult to subvert it. I just hope it's going to happen soonish in historical times. Because what the Soviet Union did to World War I was actually completely erasing the memory of World War I. And so by the time Putin's government started recovering World War I, there was very little familial memory left, a living memory of the actual sacrifices and such. So if that happens to World War II, that would be difficult. But if you undermine the Russian mythology of World War II while there is still living memory of the great grandparents and grandparents and what they went through, and there is still space for the Russian opposition, for instance, for the opposition to the it's called eternal barrack, in opposition to eternal regiment, to the if that happens, then the Russian mythology of World War II would collapse on its own, really. There is so much on it about what really was happening in the Red Army during World War II and the real contribution of the Western allies to the cause. And the immortal regiment is powerful in a way, but it can be countered by the immortal barrack and a number of other points. So if that is the foundation of a historical memory in the occupied territories, that's not so bad. Let's just happen that it doesn't come to it 100 years later, as was the case with World War One. Okay, sorry, you need to remind me now what was in the first part.
One of the questions was about the commemoration of Babin Yar that's being developed. Yeah. Let's just answer that and finish up.
Yeah. Well, Babin Yar has played a major role over the decades. My argument here is that Babin Yar was decentering symbolically the Soviet space of commemoration. The Soviets wanted to concentrate the space of commemoration in one part of Pechersk, the upper part of Kyiv on the other side. But they couldn't move Babin Yar. And Babin Yar was, from the very beginning, the inconvenient symbol of, at first and primarily the Jewish tragedy, and subsequently the tragedy of other groups as well. So the Soviets had really difficult time dealing with it. So it undermined the Soviet efforts both spatially in terms of location and ideologically. Now, what happened in Babi Yar during the 1990s was that a number of small monuments were created, and in the 2000s to each and every group. And an argument has been made by Tim Snyder that we should not be afraid of this. Because if you look at the history of some major death camps and concentration camps, they do have the same, because the monuments were constructed over time to different groups, and they do coexist in our consciousness and people of the 21st century, who understand now the value of human rights, of recognizing various marginal groups. And you can see also this happening in the Holocaust commemorations. For instance, reappearance of Roma now being fully accepted as part of the Holocaust. And as some of you perhaps know, in Kyiv, there were significant issues trying to place a monument to the Roma killed by the Nazis anywhere in Ukraine, let alone in Babi Yar. And finally it was constructed there. So what is happening now with the so-called Russian project is problematic in a few respects to me. The Russian connection is very real, but what is worst in the whole story is that it is connected also to the mass culture in a sense that tries to please both the Western audience and the Russian narrative, while not accounting for the long story of the place and the people, which story is complex. It's not, of course, just the story of we all embraced each other once on that autumn day, on September day in 1966, when Ivan Zuba gave a talk. And ever since, things have been perfect, and things have been perfect before that. No. But this part of story needs to be addressed as well. So it would involve atonement. It would involve recognition of what was done and what we can do to prevent this from happening again. But it exists in dialogue that is appropriate to the place. And I think in the Russian project, the dialogue we are being kind of pushed into is not appropriate to the place. It is a dialogue of kind of Russian inflected mass culture, which speaks with a Russian accent and somehow tries to make itself acceptable to the West as the representation of Ukrainian Baban Yar. And I'm not trying here actually to say that the Ukrainian project is perfect. My review of the Ukrainian project, I was one of the people from whom reviews were commissioned, and it is available on the internet. And it was really a very difficult review to write. But I think the Ukrainian side is missing in this conversation for all the wrong reasons. It should not be kind of the glorification of eternal friendship between Jews and Ukrainians, but it should be a proper positioning of a difficult historical events in time and space and our consciousness, as opposed to kind of mass entertainment with Russian accent.
I think that's a perfect place and food for thought for us to take away from this really excellent talk. Thank you so much for answering so many questions in such depth. And sorry to those of you who we didn't quite get to every question, but I hope that you will find something to take away from this talk. So thank you so much, Serhy. It was really a delight to listen to all of this amazing research, and we'll look forward to the publication. And let me just remind everybody, next week is our final Summer Institute public event series. I'll be back here again in conversation with Andrei Kurkov, the novelist of the book Grey Bees, which we are just now finishing reading as part of Teacup's Summer Book Club. If you would like to attend the event, please register online. I believe the link is in the chat. Let's say thanks one more to Serhy, and I hope to see you all next week at 1:15 right here. Thanks so much for coming.
Thank you so much for inviting me. And I'm sorry I didn't answer all the questions. I'm sure they were great as well. Maybe next time.
I think it's a really long ongoing conversation for us.